Tonight, the St. Lucia Employers Federation is concerned about what current difficulties facing the Bank of St. Lucia could mean for employees' jobs. Police could file homicide charges after a post-mortem determines a Barbado man died from injuries sustained in a fight. And the St. Lucia Solid Waste Management Authority devises a waste management strategy for the island. Very good evening to you. Welcome to the Thursday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. As tensions mount among workers at the Bank of St. Lucia over possible job losses, the executive director of the St. Lucia Employers Federation has weighed in on the development, expressing hope that the government will intervene to prevent this. DBS's Alex Buske begins our news coverage.
Reports suggest that the Bank of St. Lucia is in serious financial trouble due to some $3 million in bad loans. Suggestions are that several staff could be on the breadline if the financial institution cracks under the debt burden. Mr. Joseph Alexander stressed that the Employers Federation is always concerned when job security is threatened, but he expressed confidence in what he says are ongoing efforts to broker a deal that will prevent layoffs.
I think what's going on there is to prevent the layoffs, because if things remain as they are, the bank not making loans, it will have no choice but to lay people off. But if they could get this additional investment, which will allow them to make more loans, then the bank would have no need to lay people off. In fact, they would need to employ more people to disburse those loans. So I see it as a positive thing.
Alexander believes that efforts being made by the Bank of St. Lucia to woo investors is the best course of action to save the lending institution from collapse.
Government, and by extension the bank, is looking for investors to come in to invest, to put in more capital into the bank. And I think it's a good thing because if you notice, it's very difficult to get a loan these days. And so if the bank could get additional capital, that would help in the thrust that the country needs to go.
Meanwhile, the minister in the Ministry of Finance has confirmed that despite the challenges being faced by the bank, it is very liquid and that there are no plans to sell the bank. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
Meanwhile, Bank of St. Lucia customers have been voicing their concerns about news reports on what's going on at the financial institution. Don Nicholas reports.
Reports indicate that the Bank of St. Lucia is in deep financial trouble. According to the information, the institution has accumulated $300 million in bad debts. Today, we interviewed some customers who are distressed over the news.
If the bank is bankrupt, then they're in trouble. You know? Okay. The government can rescue the whole situation.
Just on Wednesday, the call went out for those responsible for the disbursement of the loans valuing $300 million to give a detailed account of the terms and conditions under which the loans were approved. Another customer has described the whole situation as unfortunate.
But it's a sad thing to see that it's a St. Lucian bank, and I've been there since when I was about 17. It's a shame to see that they sell out, but I think my options are to get out if they change. As a Republican bank, I will change.
Government is in discussions with the bank on the way forward. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
And now this story. A post-mortem examination of the body of 37-year-old Eli Mathre of Talvin Babino revealed that Mathre died as a result of a ruptured spleen with massive blood loss, secondary to blunt force trauma to the abdominal region. According to reports, on Saturday, November 26th of 2016, at about 2 a.m. at Fawaso Babino, the deceased was involved in an altercation with an individual known to him, during which he sustained injuries to his abdomen. He subsequently sought medical attention at the Victoria Hospital. On Wednesday, November 30th, 2016, at about 3:40 a.m., he succumbed to his injuries. Later that same day, a post-mortem was conducted by Dr. Heather Emmanuel. An individual is in police custody, assisting with investigations into this matter. And the sister of the deceased, Eli Mathre of Talvin Babino, has been recounting her version of what happened the day her brother was hospitalized. Here is Don Nicholas with more.
The sister of the deceased said she received a call saying that her brother was lying on the floor at the home of a neighbor. He had been hit several times with a post about the body. At that point, he was rushed to the hospital. She told us what happened next.
When I took my brother to the hospital, then they examined him. They did an x-ray, and then they did an ultrasound. They said that it doesn't look good, so they have to rush him into surgery. After the surgery, I saw my brother. When I came there the following day, it didn't look too well. And then about 4 o'clock in the morning thereabout, my brother passed.
We take in this police report. One man is currently assisting the police in their investigation. However, so far, no charges have been laid.
A post-mortem was conducted on the body of Eli Mathre by Dr. Heather Emmanuel later that same day, which revealed that he died as a result of a ruptured spleen with massive blood loss secondary to blunt force trauma to the abdominal region. An individual is in police custody assisting with investigations in this matter. This is the 26th recorded homicide for the year 2016.
The incident took place in the wee hours of Saturday, but Mathre succumbed to his injuries on Wednesday morning. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Still in the first segment of the DBS News World, the St. Lucia Vendors Association and the Office of the Mayor are at loggerheads once again, this time over the payment of rental fees, which will now attract VAT. More in this report.
The president of the Craft and Dry Goods Vendors Association, Mr. Peter Isaac, says the tenants at the Caceres Vendors Arcade learned of the development through an invoice from the mayor's office, carrying a VAT charge. Mr. Isaac is of the view that the mayor's office should have indicated its intentions to implement the charge to the association. According to him, there was no consultation on the matter.
Most members are very irate about it. They are very concerned. They are incensed about it. And a lot of them are saying that they are not paying no VAT, and they just impose that VAT on them without any kind of prior consultation. In fact, the chairman of the Caceres Constituency Council had a meeting with the vendors just last week, Wednesday, and no mention was made of implementing the 15% VAT on vendors. And today now, to implement it, I probably, one of my conclusion too as well, and some vendors are saying the same thing, probably that's the reason why they really want to slight the Vendors Association so that they could do whatever they want with vendors.
Isaac says already vendors are not making any money, and the new charge will likely place further hardship on them. But as far as the office of the mayor is concerned, the association president should appreciate that vendors have not been charged VAT since the new system was implemented in St. Lucia.
Currently, what has happened is that there was an audit by the VAT office conducted here, where the standard rated sales that was revised, and there was a discrepancy which was highlighted, of course, and we have been advised by the VAT office that the vendors, whether it be for the rental of booths or whether it be for ticketed vendors, which are the vendors, you know, along the city sidewalks, that they need to pay VAT to councils.
Hollingseed says moving forward, the matter will be discussed and clarified with the association. For the DBS News World, Sheffield Gillard reporting.
The broadcast will continue in just a moment. Welcome back to the DBS News World. St. Lucia joined the rest of the world in observing World AIDS Day today. The observance aims to unite people the world over in combating HIV. It also provides an opportunity for them to show their support for people living with HIV and to commemorate people who have died from the disease. Don Nicholas reports.
This year, the world marked the 35th anniversary of the first published reports of what would come to be known as HIV/AIDS. This disease has wrought enormous suffering and devastation and caused more than 35 million deaths. Yet, thanks to advances in medical science, persons with HIV and AIDS can live much longer productive lives. Dominican-born director of the Pan-American Health Organization, Dr. Carissa Atien, spoke of increased access to medicines to fight AIDS and other diseases.
We've been working with member states in terms of access to medicines and technology. So PAHO has a strategic fund. Now, many countries of the Caribbean have signed up to the strategic fund. We pull the demand for many of the drugs dealing with chronic diseases, with HIV, AIDS, malaria, and TB, and also supplies, and we tender on those.
Dr. Atien also spoke of the advantages of universal health care, as well as reducing the impact of non-communicable diseases. As far as Dr. Atien is concerned, it's about creating an environment where persons can live healthier lives.
So, how are we going to increase taxation on the sugary beverages? So let me mention Barbados and Dominica in the Caribbean who've done this. How are we going to remove salts from all of the tables in all of our public eating places? Mm-hmm. How are we going to have drives on alcohol so we reduce the consumption of alcohol?
As Dr. Atien puts it, it's time to break the back of non-communicable diseases. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
In other HIV/AIDS related news, health experts say although strides have been made in the fight against HIV/AIDS, stigma and discrimination continue to hold back progress in eliminating the disease completely. The experts believe that fear of stigma means that people are less likely to go for HIV testing and disclose the HIV status to others. More in this report.
The 2016 observance of World AIDS Day has brought into focus the need to end discrimination and stigma associated with the virus. That's according to the UN Special Envoy on HIV to the Caribbean, Dr. Edward Green, who stressed that World AIDS Day provides the ideal occasion to join scientists, activists, medical practitioners, and people living with AIDS around the world in celebrating the success registered in stemming the spread of the disease. He, however, cautioned against complacency that will result in the erosion of these gains. He pointed to the culture of stigma that continues to surround HIV and AIDS and that hampers access to treatment for people who are infected with the disease.
Prevention must therefore be a flagship for sexual and reproductive health and rights, age-appropriate sexual education, access to condoms and pre-exposure prophylactics. It must also be a standard bearer for reducing violence against women, girls, and adolescents, and eliminating AIDS-related stigma and discrimination.
Dr. Edward has called on society to work collectively in an attempt to eliminate fear of the disease. The call comes in light of news that St. Lucia has the second highest number of infections in the Eastern Caribbean.
Let us raise our hands in support of prevention to signal justice for all. Let us raise our voices in global chorus for prevention, ending the AIDS epidemic. This World AIDS Day, live up, hands up. Love, protect, respect.
World AIDS Day is observed annually on December 1st. For the DBS News World, Sheffield Gillard reporting.
Well, the DBS News World continues in just a moment. Developing a waste management strategy for St. Lucia. Welcome back to the broadcast. The St. Lucia Electricity Services Limited, Lucilec, has reacted to reports that individuals are presenting themselves to business establishments and or people's homes as Lucilec employees and requesting permission to access their premises to conduct inspections or work on behalf of Lucilec. The company has assured the public that instances where its employees and contractors would need to get into a building to carry out any work are rare. The company says most of Lucilec's work stops at the electricity meter. Anyone presenting himself or herself to your place of business or home as a Lucilec employee should always be asked to show the appropriate picture identification. If someone purporting to represent Lucilec or any of its contractors is requesting to get inside your office or home, you are advised to call Lucilec's customer service department to confirm if a crew was dispatched to your premises. As a general rule, the company says home and business owners should exercise due caution before letting anyone into their premises, even when individuals present themselves as representatives of Lucilec or any other service provider. Lucilec is seeking the cooperation of all its customers in ensuring that anyone seeking access to their premises on Lucilec's behalf is properly vetted. The St. Lucia Solid Waste Management Authority is working on fine-tuning a strategy for solid waste management on the island. When completed, the document will guide the work of the organization for the next decade. The exercise is being undertaken with small-scale funding assistance from the United Nations Environment Programme, UNEP. Don Nicholas has the details.
The St. Lucia Solid Waste Management Authority is in the process of developing a strategy that would take care of many of the challenges facing the organization. The document is still in its draft stage. It is expected to be submitted to Cabinet for approval.
And then that the finished strategy, the finished product, will be submitted to the Cabinet of Ministers for their approval, because it doesn't make sense doing any plans, planning strategies and so on if you don't have the blessing of the Cabinet of Ministers, or else it wouldn't get implemented.
The authority convened a workshop to fine-tune the document. Authorities say finance continues to pose a challenge to the running of the organization in terms of embarking on various projects.
To do all that, you must have the requisite financing. And that has been a problem for us in the Solid Waste Management Authority over the years. We haven't had adequate financing. Some of the mechanisms that have been put in place have not worked quite to our advantage. So we're hoping that coming out of the strategy, you have a basis for government supporting the initiatives.
The workshop ended on Thursday. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
In other news, telecommunications giant Digicel hosted its fifth annual Digicel Festival Fun Day today. The event was organized in collaboration with the Ministry of Education and the Sacred Sports Foundation. Alex Bosque has more.
The event took place at the Bosseju Indoor Facility, where special needs children from around the island participated.
It is no secret that Digicel is very passionate about special needs and that community. This year we've included a special element. We are gifting you today, and I do hope that you enjoy the gifts that we give you. I would also like to recognize the contribution of the teachers and caregivers for this community. Thanks for always being a supportive member of our family, and also for the children under your care. You each do a fantastic job.
According to the Minister for Equity, Social Justice and Empowerment, Honorable Leonard Montoute, we should not only remember those with disabilities on the day of observance, but throughout the year. He commended Digicel and the Sacred Sports Foundation for hosting the event.
I want to say that as Minister responsible for Equity, Social Justice and Empowerment, you have our full endorsement for such programs, and I want to indicate to you that in the future, we will be looking forward to collaborating and working hand-in-hand with you to ensure that we enrich the lives of our men and women, boys and girls with disabilities.
The special needs children enjoyed various sporting options such as football, cricket, volleyball, bouncing castles, hula hoop, ball pits, skipping ropes, and more. Marketing and communications executive Louis Victor says Digicel and partners have taken the initiative one step further.
We have gone one step further and we will be gifting every child present. We worked with the different institutions. The teachers facilitated the provision of their names and what it is the children wanted for Christmas this year. And so we made the purchase, and upon departure, after having a very, very amazing and fun-filled day, we will be gifting them as they depart and go home.
Digicel hosts this activity annually to treat children with special needs while raising awareness of their situation and encouraging the corporate community and the public to support them. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
The St. Lucia National Trust is preparing to hold its annual general meeting on Saturday, December the 3rd. The organization is encouraging persons who are interested in enrolling as members to come forward. The trust is hoping that many persons will accept the invitation and thus play a greater role in conserving the natural and cultural heritage of St. Lucia.
The St. Lucia National Trust is getting ready to host its 40th annual general meeting on Saturday, December 3rd at the St. Lucia Civil Service Association in Castries from 1 p.m. Our patron, who is the Governor General, will be there. We also have quite a bit to discuss pertaining to what we were able to accomplish over the last year, as well as to share our plans for 2017 and to also get our members' ideas and views as to how we should proceed. We also have some cultural performances and lots in store for our members.
The meeting will be held at the Civil Service Association building in Sanssouci from 1 p.m. Sports is next with Brian Calixt.
Good evening, welcome to the DBS Sports. We stroke off with news on cricket. The St. Lucia National Cricket Association will be hosting the sixth edition of its annual fundraising dinner tomorrow at the Bay Gardens Hotel. The event, which is expected to commence at 7 p.m., will see a number of awards being presented. The evening's highlight will be the naming of the association's junior and senior male and female cricketers of the year. Other awards will be presented tomorrow evening: the esteemed award for sporting excellence, team of the year, cricket district of the year, Administrator of the Year, Coach of the Year, Best Kept Cricket Facility, the Technical Official of the Year, Community Achievement Award for Cricketer, Coach, Administrator and District, Media Award, the Sponsor of the Year Award, and the Affiliate's Choice Cricket Personality of the Year. The guest speaker for the evening will be Honorable Dominic Fede, Minister in the Office of the Prime Minister with responsibility for tourism, information and broadcasting. The association's theme for the evening will be Teamwork Makes the Dream Work. In the region, Anthony Allen and Rakim Cornwall are the top performers following the first three rounds in the Digicel Regional 4-day tournament. Allen, the Barbados Pride's left-handed opener, has been the most prolific batsman so far with 443 runs from 5 innings in 3 matches at the average of 86.6. He entered the first break in the season with 4 successive scores of 50 runs or more, including a maiden first-class 100 of 186 against Trinidad and Tobago Red Force in the second round of matches at the Queen's Park Oval in Trinidad and Tobago, capital of Port of Spain. The 23-year-old Allen, a former West Indies under-19 player, is the only batsman to aggregate more than 300 runs for the season. And only 6 others, including former West Indies batsman Shivan Chandrapal, have reached a 200-run threshold. Cornwall, on the other hand, the Leeward Islands Hurricanes off-spinning bowling all-rounder, has been the most successful bowler so far with 19 wickets at an average of 23.68 runs apiece. The 23-year-old from Antigua and Barbuda has continued in a rich vein of form from the recent West Indies A-team trip to Sri Lanka, where he was the visitor's most successful bowler. He has twice captured 5 wickets or more in an innings, twice this season, including a best bowling performance of 6 for 82 against two-time defending champions Guyana Jaguars in the second round of matches at Warner Park in St. Kitts. So the top performers in batting: Anthony Allen, 443 runs from 3 matches. John Campbell from the Scorpions, 278 runs. Kyle Hope from the Red Fort, 255 runs. Rajinder Chandrekar from the Jaguars, 224 runs. Shama Brooks from the Pride, 208 runs. Shivnan Chandrapal from the Jaguars, 200 runs. And Nkuma Bona of the Hurricanes, 200 runs. The three wicket takers leading the pack, Rakim Cornwall with 19 from the Hurricanes. Verstami Pamol from the Jaguars with 14 wickets. Nikita Miller from the Scorpions with 13 wickets. Round 4 bowls off next week, December 8th to 11th. Scorpions take on the Red Force at Sabina Park from 10 a.m. While December 9th to 12th, the Volcanoes take on the Hurricanes at the Windsor Park in Dominica from 10 a.m. While the Jaguars take on the Pride in Guyana from 3 p.m. In football, the Grosley Football League, sponsored by St. Lucia Sports Online, continues on the weekend at the Grosley Playing Field. Tomorrow, Dominators Youth will face Radio FC. This game was originally carried for last evening, but due to the weather and poor state of the field, it was rescheduled to tomorrow. The competition continues on the Saturday, 3rd December, with the first game featuring Glass GMC United against Police at 5:30 p.m. and the second encounter featuring Massey Northern United B up against Dominators FC at 7:30 p.m. On Sunday, 4th, two more matches are scheduled. Moshi takes on Radio FC at 5 p.m. and Massey United A, they take on Dominators Youth at 7 p.m. Don't go away. We'll be right back with more sports news and action. Thank you for staying tuned. Manchester United eased into the English Football League Cup semi-finals as they beat West Ham with manager Jose Mourinho absent from the Old Trafford dugout. The Portuguese, given a one-match touchline ban before the game, stayed out of view as United set up a last four tie against Hull City. Zlatan Ibrahimovic clipped in the opening goal inside 2 minutes before former United youngster Ashley Fletcher equalised as he pounced on David De Gea's error. Anthony Martial re-established the home side's lead shortly after halftime, drilling Henrik Mkhitaryan's cross past Hammers keeper Adrian. The French international extended United's lead when he stroked in Antonio Valencia's low cross after a well-worked team move, with Ibrahimovic adding the gloss by tapping in with virtually the last kick of the game. Manchester United will play Hull in the semi-finals of the English Football League Cup, while Liverpool will take on Southampton. Hull, who reached the FA Cup final in 2014, needed penalties to overcome championship leaders Newcastle on Tuesday. Southampton, comfortable winners over Arsenal on Wednesday, will host inform Liverpool at St. Mary's before the return leg at Anfield. The two-legged semi-final ties will be played in the weeks commencing 9th and 23rd of January 2017. Liverpool winners of the competition a record 8 times, and the finals in 2016 saw off Leeds on Tuesday with a 2-0 win at Anfield. And finally tonight, well, Tiger Woods hit a one over par 73 on his return to competitive golf at a World Hero Challenge in the Bahamas. The 14-time major champion, who has twice undergone surgery during 15 months out, is 9 shots off the pace set by fellow American J.B. Holmes. Woods, 40, had 4 birdies in 8 holes, but he bogeyed the 9th after a wayward drive and poor chip. Another shot went on the 11th, while double bogeys on the 16th and 18th left the world number 898 a stroke over par. Woods said he felt pretty good and looking forward to the next few days after completing his round at the event he hosts to benefit his charitable foundation. So, a welcome back for Tiger Woods. Now to our thought to take you through the night. An insincere and evil friend is more to be feared than a wild beast. A wild beast may wound your body, but an evil friend will wound your mind. The DBS News continues. Please stay tuned.
Finally from us, on the lighter side. A curious cat was found trapped alone on the inside of a glass door in a bank in England after hours. Twitter user Jamie shared photos of the stranded cat peering longingly out of the clear bank door on Tuesday evening. out walking through town and we've just found a cat stuck in a bank, Jimmy said. The trapped feline was seen sitting alone in the closed bank and appeared to walk closer to the door as Jimmy approached concerned. It was unclear how or why the cat became trapped inside the bank, but Jimmy contacted local animal rescue authorities to ensure the cat's safety. Just to let everyone know, we called the RSPCA and talked to the restaurant next door, and they've assured us the cat will be okay, she said. And now, the usual reminder. The St. Lucia Employers Federation is concerned about what current difficulties facing the Bank of St. Lucia could mean for employees' jobs. Police could file homicide charges after a post-mortem determines a Babado man died from injuries sustained in a fight. And the St. Lucia Solid Waste Management Authority devises a waste management strategy for the island. That's a broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Poldian, wishing you a very good evening. Stand by for the program Talk, coming up at 8:30 with your host, Rick Wayne. Goodbye.